So let's build up the test statistic for one-way analysis of variance. So recall we were working with this example comparing the weight loss on one of four diets, diet A, B, C, or D. And we can see the observations here as well as the summary statistics, the mean weight loss and standard deviation of weight loss for each of the four diets. We're working with this null, assuming that all means are equal, and an alternative, at least one differs from the rest. We previously talked about how we can take the total variability in weight loss, or the total sum of squares, and separate it into two parts, that which is explained by the diet, and that which is not explained by the diet. So let's look at how we can use that to build up the test statistic. First, just a quick note on notation. And again, we want to focus on the concepts, not on plugging into formulas, but this helps us with understanding the formula and what's written in the notation. So I is used to index the group, group 1, 2, 3, or 4, K to signify the number of groups. J is used to represent the observation number within a group. YIJ tells us the individual observations in group I, observation number J. So for example, Y1, 3 is the observed value for group 1, person number 3. YI bar is the mean for group I. Y bar with no subscript is the overall or grand mean, the mean weight loss for everyone in the study. SI is the standard deviation for people in group I. And NI is the sample size for people in group I. So we saw that we can take the total variability and separate it into two parts, that which is explained by diet, and that we signified as the variance between diets, or sometimes called the mean square between. And that was the sum of squares between divided by its degrees of freedom, the degrees of freedom between groups. And looking at the formula, and again, we don't want to get stuck on this, but this helps us see the concepts we just learned from a slightly different angle. We can think of this as we're going to sum over all the groups. So group 1, 2, 3, 4. What's the sample size in each group? And how far is the group-specific mean from the overall mean squared divided by its degrees of freedom? If we work that out, for our example, we'd find that the sum of squares between groups, or the explained sum of squares, is 97.3. Degrees of freedom 3, right? 4 groups minus 1. And that's going to come out to 32.4. We also saw we can think of the unexplained, right? And again, this is the variability that's not explained by diet or not explained by X. So this is the variability going on within a group, or the mean square within. And again, this is the sum of squares within groups divided by the degrees of freedom within. And formulaically, we can think of summing over all observations. How far is each individual from their group-specific mean square divided by their degrees of freedom? Right, again, we have n observations, and we lose k degrees of freedom by estimating the k group means. We can also express this as summing over the groups. Each group sample size minus 1 times the variance, okay, the sample variance of each group, divided by its degrees of freedom. Okay, and the reason why I write it this way is you can take a moment yourself to note that this here is the exact formula for the pooled variance that we talked about in the two sample t-test, assuming equal variance in the two groups. We're taking the sample variance of each group weighted by their degrees of freedom. Okay, so you can take a moment yourself to work your way through and convince yourself that this within group variance is the exact same as the pooled variance in the two sample t-tests assuming equal variance. If you work this out, for example, you're going to find the sum of squares within a group is 297, its degrees of freedom 56, and this comes out to be 5.3. So as noted, we want to compare these two to each other. The mean square between groups to the mean square within groups. Okay, the average sum of squares that can be explained by diet, the average sum of squares that cannot be explained by diet. So let's try and think our way through some stuff first. Suppose if the alternative hypothesis is true, if at least one mean differs, if not all the means are the same, how would we expect, statistically, how would we expect the mean squares between groups to compare to the mean square within group? If diets are different, we'd expect this one should be larger than this, right? There should be much more variability that's explained by diet than not explained by diet. If we take a ratio of these, okay, and this is going to be what we call our F statistic, our test statistic, the mean squared between groups over the mean square within groups, right? If we expect the top to be larger than the bottom, we expect this test statistic to be larger than 1. If, on the other hand, our null hypothesis is true, if all the means are equal at the population level, what would we expect to see? We'd expect the mean squares between, okay, the variability that's explained by diet, to be roughly the same as the mean square within, or the variability that's not explained by diet. When looking at an F statistic, okay, we're taking the ratio of these two, we'd expect that to come out to be roughly 1. If we do this for our set of data, our F statistic, 32.4 over the 5.3, that's going to come out to be 6.1. Okay, so the larger our F statistic gets, the more evidence we have that the alternative is likely true or the null is false. While we don't want to get too caught up on looking things up in tables, it's important to note that this F statistic follows what's called an F distribution. It has degrees of freedom for the numerator and degrees of freedom for the denominator. So it has degrees of freedom for the numerator, which are k minus 1, right? Those are the degrees of freedom of what's in the numerator, and has degrees of freedom for the denominator, n minus k. Okay, so again, piece of software can do all these calculations for you. We don't want to focus on an F table and looking up an exact p-value from that table. So let's just jump to the interpretation. If we were to work this out, looking in a table or using a piece of software, p-value is going to tell us, like it always does, what's the probability of our observed test statistic, or what even more extreme, if the null is true, and we'd expect it to be 1. So what's the probability of getting an F stat greater or equal to 6.1 if it should be roughly equal to 1? If our null is true and we'd expect our test stat to be roughly 1, what's the chance of seeing an estimate of 6.1 or more? You'll find that this comes out to 0.0011, okay, roughly 0.1%. So again, if our null is true, if all these diets are the same, the chance of seeing an F stat like this, okay, the differences we saw or even larger, is only going to happen about 0.1% of the time. That gives us evidence to reject our null hypothesis. We have evidence to believe the alternative is likely true. Right? We have evidence to believe at least one diet differs from the rest. So now we need to decide which diets might differ from the others. And to do that, we're going to compare all possible pairwise means. That's a topic we're going to get to talking about in a moment.
Thanks for watching our video. Subscribe to our channel. Share our videos. Stick around, guys, because we got lots more.